Hi, welcome to everyone's favourite segment, Mailbag, where I open my mail. Let's get straight into it. First one is from Martins Lasdens, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. He's from Latvia. Hi to all my Latvian viewers. So let's slice this sucker open, and I do know what's in here, so I won't spoil it. I did deliberately open this one first, and so let's, ta-da! All right, what do we got? I better be careful with this. It is reasonably fragile, so open it up, because Martins was very generous to send this to me. It's worth quite a bit of money, so thank you very much indeed. And he heard me mention on a previous video that I needed this, or I was going to get one. I was going to get one because of what I got in a previous mailbag. So I'll get there eventually. Stick with me. Oh, this is enormous. It is ta-da, a dual Xeon motherboard, dual processor Xeon. I don't know, it's probably like one of those server motherboards, because if you remember a previous mailbag, I got two Xeon processors for my new video rendering server. And Martins was kind enough, he contacted me and said, hey, well, you know, I've got some motherboards, I'm selling these on eBay, but you're welcome to have one. So he was kind enough to send me one all the way from Latvia. So awesome, thank you very much. That looks like it's come here in very good nick. And is it a brand new one? I'm not entirely sure. He hasn't he didn't include a note, but awesome, thank you very much. I can now get my dual Xeon processors, whack them in here. I do need a case, because this is not your standard case. I can't remember the exact name of the case off the top of my head, but I do need to get a specific case which actually can actually support this main board. So there you go, if you want to have a look at that, for all you motherboard aficionados out there, fantastic. It's got a whole bunch of PCI Express slots, and look at all the memory slots. It's absolutely huge. I've got some SIMs, which I'll whack in there as well, which I got from my dumpster dive server. So this should make an awesome video rendering machine. Thanks, Martins. So this is a pretty sweet motherboard. It's a Supermicro brand, which I've heard is pretty darn good, apparently. And the model number is X9DAE, so I'll link it in down below. But basically, as you can see, it's a dual Xeon processor, the E5-2600, their socket 2011 processors, and they're the ones I got in a previous mailbag, so I have two of those E2600 series processors, so it should work a treat. But look at the amount of memory slots on this. It supports up to one terabyte of memory, apparently. I've only got like three regular server SIMs I got from I can actually pull out a few more from the old dumpster servers I've got, but yeah, that should work a treat. I don't know how many you have to actually populate, whether or not you have to populate like two in each one, or whether you can just have one in each one, or just one for a single processor. I'm not sure how that works at all, but here we go. Look at that, old-fashioned serial port on it, but I think that's common on servers, isn't it? So that you can hook up like, you know, an external serial monitor or something like that. USB 3, fantastic, old-fashioned PS2, look at that. And some Ethernet and some audio goodness on there as well. So that should absolutely scream along as a video rendering machine, I'm sure, and a ton of PCI slots, so that should work a treat. Now, I've been trying to find a layer marker, one of those transparent layer markers on here, to see how many layers this mainboard is. You usually like find them in the corners down here, but no, I can't find anything. Lots of unpopulated footprints around there. There's a huge BGA device there, unpopulated. Not sure what supposed to go in there. I'm sure somebody will be screaming at me, and they know exactly what it is. There's a SO8 with a thermal unused thermal pad, and obviously they had the paste mask, so paste was in here, so it went through on the reflow. And they've actually done that not as a solid one, but look, they've got the individual lines there, and some of the solder's just bridged across there. But anyway, we've got ourselves a, looks like a poly switch down in there, and here we go. This is interesting. Look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Are these some sort of test pads or something? They're not your traditional transparent layer counter windows, so I'm not sure what's going on there. And by the way, this is an Intel C602 chipset, so I presume the only other monster device on there is that, on the main board is that, so that must be the Intel 602 chipset. And what else have we got? Anyway, a whole bunch of stuff. I won't go through the motherboard. It's not that exciting, although I'm sure you motherboard aficionados would love to see it. And that's interesting. That looks like some sort of current sense resistor down in there near this big switching power supply. So maybe it's got some sort of overcurrent thing. That could be a little differential amp, maybe, to measure across that resistor current shunt there, perhaps. Yeah, so there's quite a lot of unpopulated stuff. There's some sort of connector, some board connector or something like that. Not sure what it is. As I said, all that stuff over there, it's probably, is that like a, that's not like a SD card thing, slots, is it? Something like that, maybe? Because some of these servers can actually boot from SD cards and things like that. I found those in my HP dumpster servers, so apparently that's what they can do. Really nice is that it's got a regular onboard USB like that, so you can just use your regular cable. That's very nice. You don't have to use the dicky pin headers and things like that. But there's, you know, not a huge amount on here. You know, you've got your two main processors, you've got your main chipset, there's lots of miscellaneous housekeeping stuff, I.O. and things like that. You're going to have all your USB chipsets, your Ethernet drivers and stuff like that, which could be down here perhaps driving that. But yeah, it's, you know, ultimately, I mean, there is a huge parts count on here, but ultimately, in terms of like major devices, it's all in the main Intel chipset up here. And if we have a look on the bottom here, there we go, they've got some Foxconn LGA 2011s there, and you'll notice that the, have a look here, look at all the bypass caps under the huge big LGA 2011 socket, and they've got individual cutouts for those. And I love the fact that they've silk screened absolutely every part, and they've, so this would be like that, so this would be the silk screen designators here for all of those bypass caps, and then that one for in there, for example. And they just, yeah, the PCB design has gone to a lot of effort, and that's not uncommon, because when you've got densely packed bypass caps like that, obviously you can't put the silkscreen designator next to each one. It's just impossible. It's not uncommon in my board layouts, when it gets very dense like this, I'd often put the silkscreen designator over here, and then like a line, like a silkscreen line going off pointing to the part. In this case, I would have said, you know, well, where's a good example? This one, I would have put a line pointing to where that actually is. Let's say if this corresponded to this here, I would have had a line, then, you know, arrow pointing over there, saying these designators correspond to those parts over there, for example. And of course, next to your main processor socket here, you've got lots of bulk tantalums like this. They're 470 mic a pop. So, you know, you can see those feeding into a big, that's actually not a ground plane, that's actually a power plane, and then that'd feed into here on maybe, well, maybe on the top layer here, but certainly going into inner layers and things like that, get into all the pins there on the main socket. And yeah, it's not easy to do a board like this. Just look at the amount of controlled impedance differential pair traces they've got coming out of here. Look at it, see all the little wiggles trying to match the length of those. So they're matching the individual one, matching the length of each one. And just wow, you know, like a huge routing effort. These ones over here, it's probably not the best light to show them, but you can see the they've actually put, so they haven't kept those actually straight like they you know, like you normally would. It's almost as if like they're hand taped or something like that. So they've just gone a little bit fancy pantsy there. Most of the other stuff on the board is kept to your regular 90 45 degree angle stuff. So yeah, they've just had a little bit of fun there, I think, the layout person.
Next up, one from Anonymous, just from the shipping department in Mesa in Arizona. So thank you very much, the shipping department in Mesa, Arizona. Well, there is a company name on here, but I'm not sure if it's a, like if that's just redistributed from them. Anyway, we'll find out. So, ta-da, let's have a look. We have, user guide. Looks like one of those satellite phone jobs. Yeah, Global Star satellite phone. Check it out. I assume that's what's in the box here. And yes, we have a note. Turns out it's from Dan, and he's from Electronic Responsible Recyclers. So they, I guess, responsibly recycle electronics. Brilliant. So they get lots of cool stuff. Tons of it. And he said, yeah, quite a few people there watch. So thank you very much, guys. And they should, send something in. But it had to be cool. It had to be just the right shade of black. And it had to be not taken apart yet. So they finally got it. And somebody said, send it to that crazy Aussie bloke here in Australia. It's an older satellite phone with a wall charger, one of those Yankee ones, and it probably works, but does have a broken cellular antenna. The concept being able to transmit in low Earth orbit. Yep. Awesome. Satellite phone. No, I haven't taken apart a satellite phone. So, fantastic. And being a specialist recycler, I guess they've got those Instapak foam things that they can... it's a bit... Box is a little bit overkill, but awesome. Thank you very much, guys. Oh, it's like sealed in the packet and everything. Wow, look at this. That's a Bobby Dazzler. Look at that. Is that the huge battery on the side? What is that? No, that's the big ass antenna, is it? Wow, look at that. Rotate the Global Star satellite antenna as shown. Brilliant. I love it. Look at that. Definitely a teardown Tuesday. Thanks, guys. Actually, I just wanted to show you this again. This is really neat. You notice how that's not sticking out very far? Look, it extends. It's becoming erect. Look at that. It's excited. Ooh, I'd be excited too if I had to transmit to a satellite in low Earth orbit. That's great. That's a neat little bit of design. The erectile antenna, I'll call that. Beauty. Next up, we have one from the old Dart from Gillies Roots from RF Solutions Limited. And, well, you know, RF Solutions are going to probably send something reasonably cool for all you RF aficionados, I'm guessing. Better by design. They are better by design, apparently. Lots of companies have that that slogan, don't they? Better by design? I'm sure they do. Anyway, whoa, pretty funky little packaging. Check that out. Individually stuck on there. That's pretty neat. And what have they sent? Very pleased to enclose a range of smart radio modules for you to take a look at. The Bravo, the Captor, and the Boogie Board 868. Remote transmitter and wireless solutions. Awesome. Thanks, guys.
And here we go. This is the Kappa, and it comes with a little, there's a little module. Look, oh, actually, there's two of them in there. Very nice little single in line pin header modules. It looks like they are 0.1 inch pin headers, so they'll probably plug into a breadboard, although you probably don't want to use it, but you can stick it onto a Vera board or something like that. And a powerful high-speed radio link. The following networks can be realized. So it can do one-to-one or peer-to-peer. I guess one to many, so it can broadcast many to one, and modem can be given a unique address. There we go. They can coexist, so they can coexist at the same time. Awesome. And addressing networks as well, the generic pre-configured address, but then you can modify that during configuration. So that's really quite neat. There you go. If you want to check it out from RF Solutions, nerds, scan your barcode. And tech specs on the Kappa, it's about, it's precisely 869 megahertz there, and bandwidth per channel 100 kilohertz, and deviation 45 kilohertz, and my plus 13 dBm transmit power, and it can go up to 115k board. Awesome. And there's a receiver sensitivity, works a day standard, can work on a standard 3.3 volt rail, no dramas whatsoever, only takes 30 at maximum power, 30 milliamps, and receiving 16 milliamps, and sleep 5 microamps. So you can put the thing into sleep mode, and that's pretty sweet. And yes, there you go, it does have a dedicated sleep pin, so you just whack that low from your micro. Of course, you're going to hook this up to your microcontroller, and Bob's your uncle. You just put the thing to sleep, and you can do your Internet of Things with your micro and a little RF transmitter. Brilliant. And here we have the Bravo T868, and this is quite neat. They've actually got some cool stuff in this range. Look, they have an industrial remote. Look at that. It's got some big buttons, big beefy sort of industrial-type case, and with up to 2 kilometers range when transmitting to this Bravo receiver here. But this receiver, which we've got here, we've got another couple in the packets here, and once again, single inline module like that, it can be set up for as a transmitter or a receiver, and they've got handheld transmitters as well. That's quite neat, and some elite receiver modules. Oh, excellent. I love these. Very professional looking range. And by that I mean range of products, not, well, 2 kilometers is pretty good for the for the Sabre there, that industrial transmitter. That's neat. I could have used those in some of the factory stuff which I was doing back in the day. And this is the Boogie Board 868, and ta-da, here it is. Check it out. It's got some very nice big screw terminals on there with the little RF SMD module with the little PCB castellations down in there, and those little half moon things, so you can, they've got just the module, and that's just mounted directly on that. There's a chip on board blob construction there. We've got another puppy down in here, and that's just got a little antenna coming out of it. A 9 volt battery snap, nice, but it'll work anywhere from 4.5 volts up to 12 volts. And as you can see, it's just designed as a simple transmitter, just basically switch inputs like that, and you can transmit various codes up to this one's got a 100 meters range in line of sight, so designed for fairly close operation, but that's pretty neat. I like that.
Next up, we have one from Germany. Hi to all my German viewers in Karlsruhe, I think it is. I believe we've had something from Karlsruhe on before, and this is from Bormann Elsa, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Probably not. The handwriting's a bit hard to read. Or is that Elsa Bormann? I'm not sure. Anyway, thank you very much. And it's a little bit, oopsie. So I'm not sure what happened in transit there, which could be an issue. I'll actually won't open this with the big knife because I could damage it. I do actually know kind of what's in here. Oh, there we go. Look, it already split on its own. So, though I don't know precisely what, I know the type of item it is. And, awesome. Fallout shelter, there you go. Obviously, for my new bunker, the EEV blog bunker. Fantastic. I can put that on the front door. That'll freak some people out in the building. Oh boy, this is from Greetings Dave, love your show. Yada yada yada. While listening to you talk about your new EEV blog bunker, there you go, on the amp hour, I thought I would appreciate this sign. Thank you very much, Tillman. I think Tillman might have sent some stuff in before, perhaps. Anyway, I noticed that you don't have Back to the Future number plate from the future, the one with the barcode. Maybe you'd like to tell us why that is. I suspect that if you don't hate it, I might get you one very soon. Yeah, I don't hate it. I just like the Out of Time number plate. I just think that's cooler than the barcode, which nobody can actually read. So there you go. Thank you very much, Tillman. This is a... Did you say hello to all my German viewers? Yes, I did. Thank you very much. PPPS, is it still 2015? It is bloody 2015. So there you go, fallout shelter. That's going straight to the pool room. Well, that's what we say here in Australia anyway. It's going straight to the bunker. And by the way, here's a photo which I posted a tweet of a long time ago. This is the tunnel which links the EV blog lab here to the bunker. Beauty. And I don't really do postcards anymore, but bugger it. Here we go. There's a nice x-ray image of a board. That's excellent. That's from Julian Schaffersel from Austria. Hi to all my Austrian viewers, not Australia. And photography.maketiny. Something like that. And I always joke that I don't know what this white stuff is. They call snow. But anyway, this is from another Austrian viewer. Doesn't say. Actually, keep up the good work, an Austrian viewer. Thank you very much. Apparently, this picture made all the... some weird animal or something made. It looks, yeah, like a... yeah, it looks like a wallaby or a kangaroo. Weird. In Austria, in the snow. Anyway, then we have one from Edwin Reed. Awesome. Let's have a look at that. That looks terrific. Sorry, there's no nice postcards in the hotel store. That's all right. That one's really nice. Look at that. Love to be there. Do some of that ice climbing. That'd be terrific. And then we have one from Ontario. Johnny. Thanks, Johnny. He's from his hometown of Bobcaygeon. Bob, I'm sure I'm pronouncing that. It's down there somewhere. There we go. For all you Ontarian viewers. And there are no kangaroos in Austria. Thank you very much, Graz from Austria. And we've got some letters. This one's from Morgan Jerome. He's from Canada. Thank you very much, Morgan. This is not the world's best letter opener, but yeah. Here we go. We don't often get letters. So anyway, Happy New Year. Thank you very much, Morgan. Awesome. And g'day to Mario Guerrero from Fort Myers in Florida in the United States of America. And looks like it might be a postcard. Oh, look at it. Thank you, thank you. Oh, a few latitudes of... It's a thank you card. A few latitudes of gratitude for all you've done. Thank you very much. And he's got a quote in there from Steve Jobs. Stay hungry, stay foolish. Yes, he gave that at the Stanford commencement address or something like that. Yeah, awesome. Words to live by. And g'day, Christoph Burbas. He's from Athens in Greece. Hi to all my Greek viewers. Haven't been to Athens. Would love to go there. And he has sent a Christmas, a belated Christmas postcard. So, sorry, it's been hanging around for quite some time. And best wishes to Mrs. and Sagan as well. Thanks. And sorry to Samuel Lourenco from Portugal. I know all my Portuguese viewers, this one's been around since December. Sorry, Samuel. So let's have a squiz in here. Ta-da. What do we got? Some boards. Awesome. Let's check them out.
I thought Samuel was familiar. He's having a second suck of the salve here. Literally, because this is an improved pick-op board, which was seen on the mail board before. And I gave him some suggestions on layout and stuff like that. And he's retweaked it, apparently. So he's got... This is the latest version of his little pick-op board. And we have a little voltage regulator board by the looks of it. It's got one of those standard footprint heat sinks, which every man and his dog seems to be using these days. And there's a blank board as well as the Kapton stencils, which, as you can tell by the purple PCBs, they come from Osh Park. And there's the little solder paste stencils, which you can get from Osh Park Stencils or Osh Stencils, whatever they call themselves. Anyway, thank you very much, Samuel. I'll link in the pick-up down below if you want to check it out.
Next up, one from Colin O'Flynn. Good on you, Cole. He's from Halifax in Canada. Let's see what Cole has sent in. Don't want to use Colin. You get shortened here. You have a name like Colin here. It's Cole. No worries. Come on. Let's have a look. We got, ta-da, oh, a coin. Canadian $2 in case Sagan collects coins. Here's one from Canada. Thank you very much. That's, I've never seen a Canadian $2 coin. There you go. Awesome. And I like the photo. I haven't read it yet, but I like the photo of that magic smoke. Looks like there's magic smoke coming out of there. I'm liking that. And Chip Whisperer. Oh, this is the Chip Whisperer. Sorry. Spoiler. It's a huge spoiler. Huge, huge, huge spoiler there. This was in the Hackaday prize contest. And this one, was it second place, I think? He won second place with his Chip Whisperer project. And it's very awesome. Anyway, I'll link it in down below. Thank you very much, Cole. And he sent in, I think it's the latest version, and he's running, that's right, he's running a Kickstarter. I believe he sent me an email. I'll have to double check. Anyway, if it is, it'll be linked in down below.
So yes, Colin does have a Kickstarter. It's got 27 days left as I record this now, and he's halfway to his goal. So definitely check this out. This is one of the coolest projects I've ever seen, and this was why it came second place in the Hackaday prize. Because if you don't know what the Chip Whisperer is, it's basically a reverse engineering and security tool that allows you, here's the Chip Whisperer board itself. This is the main controller with the Spartan 6 and the SAM 3 ARM processor on it. And then this connects over to, well, this is like, I'm not sure if this comes with it as part of the Kickstarter. I haven't looked that deeply, but this is like a reverse engineering board. Look, pin contacts for SIM cards and things like that, DIP packages, all sorts of stuff. But it allows you to like power spike chips and sort of like reverse engineer the security features in the chips, all the security fuses and stuff like that. And the software with this is very comprehensive, if I remember correctly, when I looked at it for the Hackaday prize. And that was one of the things that was so impressive about it. It's not just the hardware, but the software to back it up. And yeah, it's got some RF stuff as well, so it can probe all that. It can probe the power rails. It can not only spike them, but probe those in terms of, you know, trying to extract security information out of chips and reverse engineer them. It's just absolutely brilliant. And Colin's done an awesome job. So if you're really into reverse engineering chips, it looks like this board just breaks off there. And this is like a maybe a second training module. So it looks like that hooks up to that. Clocks. What is it? FPGA in, out, so you can probably reverse engineer FPGAs and do all sorts of weird and wonderful stuff. I just love it. Anyway, you've got to check this out. It's one of the most awesome projects. Link to the Kickstarter down below and to the original Hackaday contest. And yes, it is all open source. So it looks like you can plug your AT Megas into there and you can reverse engineer, presumably security-enabled AT Megas. So this is like a, you know, a research tool, so to speak, nudge nudge, wink wink, for you know, probing the security features of not just AT Megas, but basically any sort of chip out there. So really terrific stuff. And as I said, does it in the current domain, the you know, the power supply glitch in and stuff, so you can measure the power supply currents of how it enters modes and things like that. You've got RF stuff and everything just ties in. And yeah, if you know what you're doing, you can reverse engineer pretty much anything with this puppy, I think. So here you go. Yes, he's designed the smaller, cheaper Chip Whisperer Lite. It contains most of the features of his larger version. He's aiming to sell it around $200. So there you go. Yes, it has launched the Kickstarter campaign. Linked in down below. He doesn't say what this smoke coming out of here is, but that's, yeah, that's terrific. He's in, the one we saw here was the Chip Whisperer Lite board along with some other stuff of interest to get started. Instead of a generic USB interface, he's using an Atmel SAM 3U with custom open source firmware. Wow, he's gone to a lot of trouble. And the Spartan 6 FPGA, it's got a 10-bit ADC, 105 meg sample per second, variable gain LNA, analog front end with 55 dB of gain. Fantastic stuff, and parts of the board snap apart, and you can use those to do various stuff. So yes, it can do all sorts of amazing things, crypto analysis for decoding encrypted stuff in chips and things like that, and it can do that using the power rail. And like I think he's got a video showing like cracking a 256-bit encryption using power rail analysis. Absolutely unbelievable stuff. So definitely check this thing out on Kickstarter. Links down below. Thanks, Cole.
Next up, one from Valdis Pivas. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly. He's from, not Australia, he's from Latvia. Hi to all my Latvian viewers. So let's open this. And, check it out. Old school Nintendo Game Boy. Awesome. These are actually really quite easy to hack, apparently. You can, the interface is all standard. You can write apps and things. I think there's some sort of development kit for them, and people have turned them into scopes and stuff like that, and all sorts of controllers and things like that. So maybe that's what he had in mind. Hey, I'm Valdis. He's 11 years old. Awesome. Thanks for watching, Valdis. I'll try to watch my language in this episode. He's from Latvia in a city called Ogri. What? Anyway, I know that sounds funny. I really like your 10 as a mailbag. Some most favorite vids on your channel are dumpster diving. Yeah, haven't had much dumpster diving lately. There just hasn't been anything down there, really. People are really rich to throw out servers and plotters. Yeah, I mean, that comes from the, it's not private individual, it comes from the companies in the commercial building here that throw things out, and it's just commonplace with companies, unfortunately. He's decided to send a Game Boy from a thrift shop in his town. It was very cheap, only €1. Fantastic. $1.50 US. It also had a cartridge, but it was too heavy to ship. That's all right. So yeah, maybe if it works, well, we'll do a teardown, and that'll be a teardown Tuesday, and maybe we can do some reverse engineering. Looks in pretty good nick for its day. Awesome. Thanks, Valdis. And we've got to have one from Australia. No worries. I think it's Ian. I think it's a bit hard to read that handwriting. Anyway, thank you very much. Let's have a look at what's in here. It feels a bit weighty, so looks like we've got some sort of data sheet. Woo! Let's, yeah, Ian. Yes, it is. Hey, what is that? That's Newage International Limited. Check that out. It's like potted. It's rather unusual. Look.
Check this out. The magic smoke has well and truly escaped. Look, you can see the potting compound here, right? But look at that. There's two resistors under there, and this, all that potting compound is just burnt right around this big resistor. So is this sucker heated up, or have those ones look like they got some burn marks in there, but then it doesn't have, the pattern doesn't look to be, it's more like this one heated up or something. Anyway, something's gone horribly, horribly wrong with this puppy, and yeah, I don't know what. I'd say it's seen better days. The magic smoke has escaped, and here it is. Here we've got the data sheet, automatic voltage regulator. This is hilarious. Look at this. The design employs surface mount technology for high integration of features in a small footprint AVR. Okay, where's the surface mount stuff? Is it on the bottom of the board? Because this is all big ass through hole stuff. This could have been made in the 70s, for goodness sake. It's like, there's nothing surface mount on there unless there's something on the bottom, some sort of controller, maybe. Or is that, maybe that's what they're talking about, maybe the puppy in there, is that the main controller? I have no idea what this thing does, really. So what I can tell, this thing is used on these generators, like these, you know, backup diesel or whatever generator sets. And then it takes the AC input from that. Here we go. Here's the spec. So it takes that from the generator winding. In this case, it's 240 volts AC power input, and it outputs a nominal 85 watts DC at 207 volts AC. Is it not that regulated? Anyway, at a continuous 4 amps. Look at this, though. This is curious. Output resistance 15 ohms minimum. That is seems extremely high to me. Anyway, no, there we go. Plus minus 1.5% voltage regulation, thermal drift. That seems pretty good. But there we go. And I think these are designed to, yeah, using these backup generators, I suspect. So no, there's nothing. There's nothing under there. That's just a big block by the looks of it. And we've got three, are they TO220 type packages in there perhaps? But anyway, they're against that heatsink. And no. So yeah, where these surface mount parts are, they might be in the bottom, but there's no way I'm getting all this gunk out of here anytime soon. So yeah, that's well and truly gonski. I'm not even going to bother to power that up. Something horrible has gone wrong there. So yeah, it's, you know, the output designed to go on the output of a three-phase brushless alternator, although it only says this is a one-phase job. Anyway, so yeah, Ian asks, they come across these things all the time. Can I suggest a reliable method for bench testing these units? Well, continuous load here, 4 amps. So you might put a constant current load on the output. For example, have we got the, yeah, we've got the pinouts in here. So there we go. Frequency selection, 50, 60 hertz. And anyway, it looks like we do have, and there's power range. Geez, 100 kilowatts. Oh man. And anyway, here looks like we've got ourselves the block diagram of this puppy. So that's yeah, I would put, I assuming that it's only got the one output. I don't know, I haven't looked into all the details. This is certainly not my field, all these alternator and gen sets and all that sort of jazz. But yeah, I'd be putting, you would want to test these things at load, at the maximum load. So I'd be putting a 4 amp constant current load on the thing to extract 4 amps from it, and then power it up and, I don't know, check it with a thermal camera maybe, see if anything heats up abnormally. That's a bit, that's going a bit far. You basically want a go, no-go test for these things, I suspect. But yeah, maybe test it over and sweep the input voltage range, for example. So you could get a, you know, some sort of automated variac or something like that, you know, that you could sweep the input range and measure the output range. You know, you could design a fully automated jig for that if you're really, you know, if you're really that keen. Although if you only saw a few of these every now and then you wouldn't bother. But if you're manufacturing these in, you know, some sort of quantity, then you would certainly go to that sort of effort. Otherwise, not just a constant current load. Maybe just vary the input with a variac or whatever, however you want to input it. And Bob's your uncle. If this is the block diagram of it, then you've got things like a short circuit detector, for example. So maybe you've got to short the output and make sure it does its business, whatever it does when the thing shorts out. We've got stability control. So, you know, if you wanted to really check the specs that it was still functional, you might have to check the output stability and things like that. But then we've got droop functions and, yeah, I don't know. I don't know enough details. You really have to read into it to know how much you wanted to actually test on this thing.
I think this might be the last one. This is from Hotch. He's from in New Lenox in IL, Illinois, I think. And let's take a look. Thank you very much. Let's have a look what's in here. Ha! Chocolate. Beauty. And what else? A disc. Dave Jones, soundboard setup. Compatible with Windows 7. What soundboard setup? Got no idea. Looks like I've got to read the note. Hey, he's made some software. It's a Dave Jones soundboard. The way it works is you click on the buttons in the same one of my phrases. Awesome. Been watching the EV blog every week when he get home from school. He's still at school. Thank you very much, Zachary Hotch, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. It's all right. I'm going to have to try out the software soundboard.
All right, here we go.
Hi.
Welcome to Dave Jones soundboard. Install. It's installing. It's doing something horrible to my machine. Yes. I do trust it. Foolishly.
Come on, you can do it. Bloody CD drives are so slow. Ancient technology. CDs date back to the early 80s. Unbelievable. Still using them. Here we go. Got to install it. Why can't we just have a single EXE that just runs? I mean, you know, back when I was a boy. No, it's installation rubbish. Even with Windows, it was like, yeah, I'd happily do a compile a single EXE that just ran. Here we go. Launch the Dave Jones soundboard. We're in like Flynn. Look at this. Ha ha. Here we go.
Hi. Stay here on the EEV blog. Don't turn it on. Take it apart. Oh my goodness. Look at that. Oh. Hey. Oh man. Wow. All this chocolate.
Brilliant. Thanks.